Good morning. Welcome. Please sign in on the friendship pads at the end of the pews. We've had a beautiful week. It is Palm Sunday, the first Sunday of spring. And if that isn't enough to get you excited, I've seen Easter eggs all over the TV the last 3 days, and they are giant. They're orange and about this big and round. So one of those things should have you excited this time of year. If you would please rise and join in the call to worship. They brought the colt of a donkey to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it.
As he rode along, the people kept spreading their cloaks on the road.
And as he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying,
"Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven."
Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." And he answered them,
"I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out."
And we can shout along with our singing as we join the praise team.
Alive. children, may see Hosanna spring. Now at the King of Israel, the David's royal son, who in the Lord's name cometh, the King and Blessed One. All glory, honor, honor to the Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children and sweet hosannas ring. The company of angels are praising thee on high, and we with all creation in chorus make reply. All glory, Lord, and honor to the Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children made sweet hosannas ring. The people of the Hebrews with palms before thee went. Our prayer and praise and anthems before thee we present. All glory, Lord, and honor to the Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children make sweet hosannas ring. To thee before the passion they sang their hymns of praise. To thee now I exalted our melody we raise. All glory, Lord, and honor to the Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children make sweet hosannas ring. The dead accept the praises, accept the praise we bring, who in all good delights, thou good and gracious King. No wonder from the pathway if thou wilt be my guide. Oh, let me feel thee near me, the world is ever near. I see the sights that dazzle, the tempting sounds I hear. My foes are ever near me, around me and within. But Jesus, draw the nearer and shield my soul from sin. Oh, let me hear thee speaking in accents clear and still. Above the storms of passion, the murmurs of self-will, oh, speak to reassure me, to hasten or control. Oh, speak and make me listen, thou guardian of my soul. Jesus, thou hast promised to all who follow thee, that where thou art in glory, there shall thy servant be. And Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Oh, give me grace to follow my master and my friend.
I want to point out there's several announcements in your bulletin. Look at those for times of events happening this week. Now, if you join in the opening prayer. Gracious God, as we enter this holy week, strengthen us to move beyond the festive parade of palms and to follow Jesus into the way of the cross, that united with him and all the faithful, one may enter the gates of righteousness into the eternal city, the new Jerusalem, where we may rise with you, Holy Spirit, forever. Amen. You may be seated, and if the kids want to come down, Carol.
Good morning. How is everybody this morning? You're going to hear this same story a lot, but what is today?
Palm Sunday,
yes. And if you kind of remember the story, I'm going to go through that kind of quickly. Jesus and his disciples were outside of Jerusalem. They were coming in, and Jesus told a couple of his disciples, go get this donkey for me. You're going to see a donkey there. And so he did. The disciples went up, but before they went, they said, well, that would be stealing if we just take that donkey. And Jesus said, no, it's okay. You just tell them that the Lord sent you to take the donkey and you'll bring it back. So they brought it back and they put their jackets or their coats on the donkey, and Jesus got on the donkey and rode the donkey in. And there were several of Jesus' followers that were so excited, and they were all lined up and they saw Jesus coming, and some of them didn't have jackets, so they took palms from the palm tree and laid them down for the donkey to walk on. That's where we get Palm Sunday, because they laid the palms down on the ground and the donkey took Jesus over those palms. They were all saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, we're so excited to see you because we know that you are the King. Well, I was working on this during the week, and then this morning I got up early and I was working on it again. And I was thinking about some different things, and I thought, I wonder why Jesus chose a donkey. Anybody have any ideas? Why do you think Jesus chose a donkey?
Because it's a donkey.
Anybody else have any ideas? Why didn't he choose a horse or a cow?
There weren't very many of them back then.
That's a good answer. Maybe there weren't very many of them. Well, I heard this story. I'd heard it before, but I heard it again this morning from Alex, but I had kind of forgotten about it. But when we were in Israel, we walked a lot of the places that Jesus walked, and we were at the spot where they would have been, and you kind of were on a hill, and you kind of looked down into this valley. It was called the Mount of Olives. And so as we were standing there, they kind of told this story about, you had to see this in your mind, that here where we were standing would have been Jesus on the donkey with all the people that were following Jesus, all of his disciples and his followers. And then across the way here on the other hill, do you know who was over there? The Roman soldiers. And the Roman soldiers, of course, had these great big magnificent horses. They probably had some armor and shields, and they had swords. Now think about that. Here's Jesus on this little donkey, and here's all these Roman soldiers over here who didn't like Jesus very much. Well, here's what I got out of that. Jesus is the real king, and he doesn't care. He doesn't care if you have a big horse. He doesn't care if you have swords. He doesn't care if you have armor. He just wants your heart. That's all he cares about. And guess what? If you follow Jesus, you're going to be the winner. So just remember that. Would you pray with me? Father God, we just thank you for the blessings of these children in our congregation. And we especially bless you, Lord, that you gave your son for us. And I just want us to always remember that, put that in the back of their minds, that in the end, we will be the winners. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, as the kids go downstairs, let us celebrate together that we have children in our church. Amen. In your bulletin, you will notice a little insert. It's like a little half-page insert. And all this is it's a little invitation that's written so that you can hand it out to someone this week. Maybe a neighbor, a friend, a coworker, someone that you think would be great to have with us next Sunday as we celebrate together Good Friday and Easter. It has the times of our services there. And the Good Friday service, we will be reading through John chapter 18 and 19, which is the story of the Passion. And we'll be doing a tenebrae service, and several people have asked me what that means. And what that means is that it means shadows, and so we will have candles lit that will go out one at a time as we read the story. And what that means is it's a symbol of this coming darkness of Jesus' death on the cross. So it's a powerful visual for Good Friday. But I must tell you, if you're coming to Good Friday service and if you're going to bring someone with you, you have to also bring them to Easter morning here or in some church somewhere, because the Good Friday service is not going to end with the triumph of Easter morning. But this is the opportunity. We've sent out letters, put it on Facebook, posted around town, told people at Fellowship Diner, told people at Celebrate Recovery, gave it to the parents that come for Kids for Christ. But we need to all participate together in sharing the good news. Well, as we go now into a time together of prayer, does anyone have a prayer request they would like to share? Ugh. A prayer request they would like to share. Thank you for laughing, Martha. And or a praise report.
My aunt fell this week, and she's pretty bruised up. Her name is Vi Newnham. Keep her in your prayers.
Okay, Brenda's aunt. I want to remember in prayer this morning also two neighbors of Jeff and Katie, Roy Smith and Wayne Crabtree, who are both battling some pretty vicious cancer. So for them and their families. Anyone else this morning?
I have a praise. The bus started this morning. We made our first route today and it went great. So anybody wants a ride? Just call into church during the week and we'll pick you up on Sunday.
Okay. Bus route, taxi service. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Anyone else? Connie?
Yes, I'm with Bill's niece and my niece.
He's got a mic for you.
Oh, thank you.
Bill's niece and my niece, of course, by marriage. She's 46 years old, and she had two strokes. And she's now, she cannot speak, and she lost her sight for a while, but that's come back. And her whole right side, she can't move her arm or her leg.
Okay.
And she cannot communicate. She can say a few words, but what's in her mind, she cannot speak. So we would appreciate your prayers for her.
What's her name?
Her name is Becky.
Okay, for Becky.
Becky Holgate.
All right, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. God, as we gather together, gather us up to you. Take us straight to your heart. Help us to know that you are near. Help us to hear your voice and to know that you are present with us, that your steadfast love endures forever, that you never leave, you never abandon, you never forsake your children whom you love. As Jesus draws near the cross, draw us near the cross. And as Jesus rises again, let us rise with him. By his grace, by his power, by his mercy, that we might experience the full life of a resurrected life. God, we ask that you would be with all of those in our community who need your peace. As we celebrate Palm Sunday, a peace that is different from what the world offers, a peace that is different from just the absence of anxiety, a peace that stays, a peace that endures even through suffering, even through pain, even as families are torn apart, as communities deal with things like drugs and unemployment, as we deal here, even as we fight cancer and strokes and diseases and all kinds of natural evil. God, that you would be present, that we would know that you are Emmanuel, God with us, and that you would lift our spirits through your peace, a peace that never fades, and that you would bind us together as we worship and as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as Carol told the kids this morning, we worship a king that is a little bit different, and we offer up praise and sacrifice to him, offerings unto him, who we know is different than any other king who has ever come or who will ever come again. So as we give our offerings this morning, give freely, give in celebration to the king who marches to victory. Let's dedicate these offerings to the Lord together. Holy One, we give you thanks for the great deeds of salvation that you have done and continue to do. Bless these offerings of thanksgiving that they may further your kingdom in this world. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the
First reading this morning is from Psalms 118, verses 1 and 2, and then 19 through 29. In your pew Bible, it's in page 541. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank thee that thou hast answered me and hast become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech thee, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech thee, give us success. Blessed is he who enters in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal processions with branches up to the horns of the altar. Thou art my God, and I will give thanks to thee. Thou art my God, I will extol thee. I give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. And from our gospel, if you would rise, if you are able. We're reading from Luke 19, 28 through 40, and it's in page 79 of the New Testament. And when he said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany at the mount, which is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, go into the village opposite where you are entering. You will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it, you will say this, the Lord needs of it. So those who were sent away and found it as he had told them, and as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, why are you untying the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of it. And they brought it to Jesus. Throwing their garments on the colt, they set Jesus upon it. And as he rode away, they spread their garments on the road. And as he was now drawing near at the descent of the Mount of Olives, a whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees in the multitude said to him, teacher, rebuke your disciples. And he answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. May the Lord bless the reading and the hearing of his word. Please be seated.
Thank you, Alex. Palm Sunday is the final Sunday of Lent, the beginning of Holy Week, or Passion Week, chronicling the last 7 days of Jesus' earthly ministry, and remembers the triumphant arrival of Jesus in Jerusalem, Israel's capital city. Let us pray. God, this Palm Sunday, we proclaim Jesus King through the power of his life, death, and resurrection. Help us to put all our hope in Jesus Christ. Amen. Long live the King. This message is full of contrast because Palm Sunday is full of contrast. The events of Palm Sunday stand in contrast to the events later in the week. Those who follow Jesus contrast those who do not. The kingdom of God is contrasted with the kingdoms of this world. And expectations of Jesus come face to face with the reality of Jesus. Jesus the prophet. The God of all realms borrows an untrained colt. He rides the foal of a donkey into Jerusalem, thus fulfilling what the prophet Zechariah had written in 9:9. Behold, your king is coming to you, righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. When the people shouted, Hosanna, and laid out their cloaks, and cut palm branches to lie on the street, then the people hailed his entry, singing the words of Psalm 118:26, Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Later, when the Pharisees order Jesus to silence his followers, Jesus responds with Habakkuk 2:11, which in its original context was about corruption. Within this dynamic recalling of ancient scripture, something more significant is happening than mere literary allusion. Jesus is both enacting prophecies of Israel's past, and he is acting as a prophet in both the aspect of judgment and foretelling. Jesus is a prophet in a twofold sense. First, he fulfills what the prophets before him have said. And second, Jesus acts and the events in his life fulfill what he has said. Here we see Jesus as prophet, one of his three offices. The threefold office of Christ is a long-standing Christian doctrine, first described by Eusebius and later developed during the Reformation. The three offices that Jesus fulfills are prophet, priest, and king. Israel's prophets define the coming Messiah, and then the Messiah redefines the office of the prophet. Israel's prophets proclaim the word of God to Israel. They preface what they have to say to Israel with words like, Thus says the Lord, and hear the word of the Lord. In the Gospels, however, Jesus not only proclaims God's word, he is God's word. Israel's prophets define the coming Messiah, and then the coming Messiah redefines the office of the prophet. Jesus can do what all the prophets of old can do, and more. Jesus transcends Israel's understanding of the prophet. Thus, Jesus is contrasted with the prophets of Israel's history. Jesus the King. The people shouted, Hosanna! And laid out their cloaks and cut palm branches to lie on the street. Palm branches symbolized peace and victory. All of these actions signified an acknowledgement of a regime change. The people sang Psalm 118 and they added King to the lyrics. They are proclaiming Jesus King. In their minds, Jesus is to be the next king of the new and improved nation state of Israel. This is the belief they put their hope in. But it's not what Jesus has promised, nor what God has ever desired for humanity. God always desired theocratic rule, which is God directly with his people, without anyone in between. But first they begged Moses to shield them from the thunderous voice of the Almighty. And then they distanced themselves further. This led to the prophets, which led to the kings, which led to ruin. Jesus will not be like any of the fallible human kings of Israel's past, because when Jesus takes the throne of David, he does so as the incarnate God-man. God does not put another human on the throne. God himself comes to sit on the throne. Thus, Jesus is contrasted with the kings of Israel's history. Jerusalem is the most dangerous place Jesus could ever go. Think about it. Jesus poses a threat to those in power. Those who seek to uphold the current systems of political and religious power are those who stand to lose the most as support for Jesus' way grows. He is a threat to the Jewish elite. He tells them that everything they have built, everything they have worked for, their system is broken. It does not bring salvation. Nothing is harder to admit than that the way we have always done things has been a waste of time. He is a threat to Rome. Jesus poses a real military threat. Even if you denied his supernatural powers, his speaking alone is popular enough to incite an uprising. A powerful Jesus in Jerusalem is more of a threat than Jesus going to Rome itself. Judea is where his people are. Judea is where Jesus' power base is. Judea could become a Jewish Messiah's operational command, the place to launch a major offensive campaign against Rome. It is not only significant that Jesus goes to Jerusalem, but how he goes to Jerusalem. Jesus chooses to enter a life-threatening place without military might or even basic physical protection. To enter Jerusalem after garnering such support from the people was dangerous. But this week, entering Jerusalem was even more dangerous. There was a second procession into Jerusalem that Passover week. From the west, Pilate came, draped in the gaudy glory of imperial power. Horses, chariots, and gleaming armor. He moved in with the Roman army at the beginning of Passover week to make sure nothing got out of hand. Insurrection was in the air with the memory of God's deliverance of the Hebrew people from the slavery in Egypt. Jesus made his entry from the east. Jesus entered without horses, without chariots, without armor, without soldiers, riding a young donkey in commoner's clothes. Two different processions, two different authorities, two very different agendas. The Pax Romana meets the Pax Christi. Pax means peace. Pax Romana meant the peace of Rome, which was an oxymoron because Rome established peace through war, genocide, and slavery. The Pax Romana mocked the true peace of God's shalom. For the first time, the Pax Romana meets the Pax Christi. Zechariah 9:9-10. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout loud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, on the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. Here arrives a new kind of king who could establish peace not through war, genocide, slavery, and temporary treaty, but by dismantling the very weaponry of war. Here arrives Jesus on a colt. The people knew their scripture. They are prompted by this act, and they respond with an amended version of the 118th Psalm. They add king to Psalm 118. Not only do they hail the arrival of a new king, but they broadcast that this new king will have implications for heaven itself. The praise they sing, peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven, imitates that from Luke's birth narrative. Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth peace. But the difference is that more and more of the supreme power of the Prince of Peace is arriving. This new king appears humble, but has the very kingdom of heaven at his back. Jesus comes to challenge Caesar, and with him, the kingdom of heaven comes to challenge the kingdoms of the world. This is a clash of kings. This is a collision of God and empire. Pilate has come to Jerusalem representing Rome, the greatest empire the world has ever seen. And Caesar, the embodiment of imperial power, military might, and idolatry, a human ruler worshipped as a god. Rome was famous for peace through violence. And their greatest Caesar was known for the slogan, Vini Vidi Vici. I came, I saw, I conquered. Next slide, Mark. Jesus answers Caesar's Vini Vidi Vici with Ego a me. Ego a me is Greek, and it means I am. What is the significance of Jesus saying Ego a me? I am is God's self-given name. Jesus connects himself to God's holy name. In declaring Ego a me, I am, Jesus is connected to the Tetragrammaton, Yahweh, one of the seven names of God from Jewish tradition, the most frequent name for God used in the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament. It is the same name for God as the Hebrew, Eyeh Esher Eyeh, meaning I am that I am, or simply, I am. I will be because I will be. I exist without having been created. Jesus does not use the past tense form of ego en, I was, but rather ego I me, I am. He does this repeatedly, as recorded in the Gospel of John. One example from John chapter 8. When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know I am. John Chrysostom wrote, as the Father uses the expression I am, so also does Christ, for it signifies continuous being, irrespective of all time. Caesar's power catchphrase is, I came, I saw, I conquered. Jesus' power catchphrase is, I always have been, and I always will be. Jesus isn't just coming in the name of the Lord. Jesus the Lord is coming. Jesus the King stands in judgment of every human ruler. The kingdom of Christ is an indictment of every human government. Thus, Jesus is contrasted with Rome. I need your help for the rest of the sermon. If you hear me say, long live the King, I want you to shout, long live the King. So long live the King.
Long live the King.
The disciples and Pharisees. There are two distinct responses to Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. One response is from Jesus' disciples, and the other comes from a group of Pharisees. The disciples are proclaiming Jesus King. The word multitude indicates that this present group of disciples constitutes a great number, way more than a dozen. This is the first time we are seeing some of Jesus' followers referred to as Jesus' disciples. Remember, in Israel's history, Jerusalem was a place of special connection between heaven and earth. Jerusalem was the holy city because it contained the holy temple, which contained the holy of holies, where God's holy presence was most fully manifested on earth. Right or wrong, the Israelite people believed that God's place on earth was in Jerusalem. Think about the significance of this. At this point, God has been symbolically absent from Jerusalem for centuries. Jesus, being God, is now re-entering Jerusalem. The people assume this portends well for Israel's future. The multitude of disciples is so excited they cannot contain themselves. The Pharisees want to shut it down. The Pharisees acknowledge that Jesus has authority, but they do not acknowledge that he has unlimited authority. The Pharisees see Jesus as pull with the people, his disciples, and the crowd. They acknowledge that others accept Jesus' authority, but they themselves do not assent to his authority. If they did accept his authority, they would never presume to tell him what to do. See, they've missed the point of what just happened. They address him as a teacher. But Jesus hasn't come to earth or to Jerusalem principally to be a teacher. Jesus has come to reign as the King of Kings. We do not know what the Pharisees' motivation is. Are they embarrassed by exuberant praise? Do they disagree with the claim that Jesus is the Messiah? Are they afraid of Roman retaliation on their people? Do they like Jesus, but fear for his safety? Their motivation is of little consequence. Their actions reveal their true belief. Jesus is not God to this group of Pharisees. If he was, they would never presume to give him an order. Their mistake, they thought they could control Jesus. They thought they were in charge. Silly Pharisees. Thus, the response of the disciples is contrasted with the response of the present Pharisees. King Jesus rides on. Long live the King.
Long live the King.
The issue of peace lies at the heart of this passage. Pax Romana versus Pax Christi. What is peace? How is it defined? How is it attained? Humanity does not know the answer apart from God's revelation. Humanity has been tainted by sin. An evil road does not lead to good. Evil leads only to evil. One cannot move further into darkness, further away from the light, and expect that light is going to be waiting for them. The idea that some evil is necessary to accomplish greater good is the oldest trick in the book. You cannot accomplish good with evil. A disciple of Christ can never claim that the ends justify the means. For anyone seeking to be Christ-like, the ends are the means. The way you achieve is more important than what you achieve. Love does no harm. Peace through violence is an irreconcilable contradiction. If we were to read a little bit further in Luke's Gospel to verse 42, we'd hear Jesus lament that the city's rejection of Jesus and his way sealed their fate. Ignorance, arrogance, and violence determined Jerusalem's destiny. Jesus says in verse 42, this is to Jerusalem, "Would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace." I see him pointing to himself. Jerusalem, would that you, even you, had recognized this day peace. But now these things are hidden from your eyes. Jerusalem did not recognize peace when it rode into their very midst. Were we to read on in Luke, we would see that the vast majority chose violent selfishness over self-giving love. All of the empire's citizens and collaborators, all the upholders of the status quo, the defenders and patriots of the world's domination system, continued to choose a warped, depraved, parasitic version of peace when presented with the humble beauty of Jesus. Before the resurrection, even the disciples were seduced by power displays. Healings, exorcisms, resuscitations, feeding thousands effortlessly. All of these things would be good talents for a violent revolution. They hoped for General Jesus. Paradoxically, Jesus' greatest act of power is where whenever he chose humility. Nothing took greater power than to willingly choose not to exercise supreme power. The multitude proclaims peace in heaven. Luke has previously written concerning peace on earth, as in the birth narrative. So why now peace in heaven? This is a foreshadowing of what is to occur that week. In only 1 week's time, through what is accomplished by way of both the cross and the empty tomb. Heaven is not an over there detached kind of place. Heaven is an overlapping reality. Heaven is overtaking the earth. The kingdom of heaven is the kingdom of God, is the kingdom of Christ.
Heaven is not about a place on a map. Heaven is about the reality which comes when the right person is on the throne. Proclaiming peace in heaven is not an affirmation of our desire to escape this world, but rather an expression of our desire for God to fully reclaim this world. Affirming peace in heaven anticipates the arrival of peace on earth. The disciples hoped so hard that Jesus would win peace that they missed that Jesus was peace. Jesus stands in judgment of our ideologies. Herein lies the danger of coming to Jesus with preconceived assumptions of knowing what he is all about. Don't put Jesus in a box. We try to force Jesus to be whatever we want him to be. If you think Jesus came to revolve around you, you are gravely mistaken and in for a rude awakening, my friend. Jesus should be our center. We were created to revolve around him and his love. Thus, the peace of Christ is contrasted with the lie of peace through violence. When confronted with the world's violence, respond with the peace of Christ. Long live the King. Today, this Palm Sunday, we remember Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem, and we join with the great multitude of disciples who proclaimed, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." We join the crowd shouting with joy for the arrival of our salvation. Today we join the disciples in the crowd in naming Jesus our Savior and King, in choosing Jesus over Caesar, peace over violence, power under versus power over, serving over controlling. Yet, while we join the disciples in the crowd in paying tribute to Jesus as King, we also join the disciples and crowd as they lose faith, disobey, fall asleep, doubt, betray, deny, and abandon Jesus. Those who rejected Jesus and condemned him to death included the political authorities, the religious authorities, the status quo defenders, and the crowd, and the disciples. We participate in the triumph, and we participate in the tragedy to follow. Thus, the triumph of Palm Sunday is contrasted with the tragedy of the Passion. The crowning of a king is contrasted with the shameful criminal's death on a cross. The disciples who marched triumphantly with him will abandon him not even a week later. The crowd which shouted, "Hosanna," will instead shout, "Crucify him." Jesus' triumphant processional into Jerusalem was not about sharing insider information with insiders. Jesus' triumphant processional into Jerusalem was about sharing insider information with outsiders. Jerusalem was a hostile mission field. The reason to enter Jerusalem was to proclaim the coming reign of Jesus Christ. Jerusalem did not want to hear the message, but they needed to hear the message. Jesus was strong enough to deliver the good news, even though he knew it would mean his death. Jesus' height of strength came from the depth of his love. By his power, we need to be strong enough to deliver the good news to even those who do not want to hear it. We cannot just share the gospel within the church walls and pat ourselves on the back. We must join Jesus' triumphant processional with the knowledge of where the road leads. We must go with him to the very foot of the cross. Come and then go, like a heartbeat. Come, go, come, go. Come witness the triumph of the King of Kings. Go tell everyone. Come witness the arrival of the Prince of Peace. Go tell everyone. Join Jesus' triumphant processional with the knowledge of the resurrection. What that means is this: because you know the end of the story, you know the good news of the empty grave, you can endure every shame and suffering, even death if it is for the sake of Jesus Christ. The implications of joining Jesus' triumphant processional on Palm Sunday are remorse for every time we have been abandoning disciples in our faithlessness, repentance for our part in the crucifying crowd, and reconciliation to the one true King who raises us into new life. Remorse, repentance, reconciliation. Let your life be changed by his offices, his politics, his peace. The way to the throne is through the cross. Long live the King.
Long live the King.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Want to celebrate on Palm Sunday, and it's right to do so, but we can't do it without also knowing what's to come later this week as we finish up Lent and move into Holy Week, looking towards the cross. The proper response to Palm Sunday is first celebration, but then remorse, repentance, and reconciliation. May we join Jesus' triumphant processional out into the streets of Rockville, into the streets of every city on this planet, proclaiming the true peace, the true King, the true love who has come and will one day soon come again. Long live the King.
Long live the King.
Go in God's peace.